Hi, my name's Caitlin. I am an SI leader for BCH 4024 at UF, and today we'll be examining the protein-ligand interactions, specifically in the context of hemoglobin and myoglobin binding to oxygen, which should be from your notes. So first, we should examine why we have this interaction between oxygen, the ligand, binding to a protein like hemoglobin or myoglobin. So in order for your body to function, you undergo metabolism. And for metabolism to occur, your body needs oxygen. However, oxygen is a nonpolar molecule, whereas water is a polar molecule. This means that oxygen is not soluble in water and thus would not be soluble in your bloodstream. Instead, we have to have a protein carry oxygen to your muscles in your body that are undergoing metabolism. Now, to do that, we need hemoglobin. So as I've written out, hemoglobin will carry oxygen from your lungs to the peripheral tissues of your body. From there, it dumps the oxygen into the tissues to your myoglobin. Similarly, myoglobin is located in the muscle, and I think an easy way to remember that is to think of the myo prefix of myoglobin, which should sound similar to myosin, a protein that's located in your tissues of your muscles, as you should have learned in biology too. All right, so now we will examine the structures of our proteins of interest, which are hemoglobin and myoglobin. Now, what both of these structures have in common is this 8-helix polypeptide. The first thing to note is that hemoglobin is a tetramer, which means it has 4 subunits, and each subunit consists of this 8-helix polypeptide. So it has 4 of those, and you'll see in your notes that it kind of looks like a little cube where in each corner there is a polypeptide subunit. Myoglobin, however, is a monomer, meaning that it only has one 8-helix polypeptide structure. It only has one and no more than that. Now, for your tetramer and hemoglobin, you'll note that 2 of them are alpha subunits and 2 are beta. You'll definitely want to remember that for the exam. Now, as far as cooperativity goes, you'll see in hemoglobin, there's positive cooperativity. This means that as each consecutive oxygen molecule binds to the protein, it increases either the affinity or the availability of those subunits of oxygen to bind to the protein. However, myoglobin, since it only consists of one unit, there's nothing for it to cooperate with. So in this case, we'll note that there's no cooperativity of myoglobin to oxygen. This is reflected in both of the curves for each protein. You'll see a sigmoidal curve, or the S-shaped curve, is characteristic of hemoglobin. Now this shows that as partial pressure of oxygen increases, the binding of oxygen to the protein increases dramatically as we start increasing the partial pressure of oxygen. Eventually, it levels out as it gets to the maximum saturation. However, since myoglobin has no cooperativity, it has a hyperbolic curve, and this should be characteristic of your standard Michaelis-Menten saturation kinetics. All right, now we will be looking at our Hill model of cooperativity. Specifically, this is going to be used for hemoglobin, since we know that myoglobin does not show any cooperativity. Now, what I've drawn here is P stands for protein, and I've drawn a cube with 4 smaller squares inside. This shows the 4 different subunits of our protein of interest. In this case, it's hemoglobin. And then I have it being added to N number of ligands, and N stands for infinitely cooperative cooperative sites. Next, I show in the Hill model that each ligand fills up all the subunits of the protein. Now, in Dr. Pirich's notes, he writes the Hill equation. And you're not expected to memorize this equation or be able to use it, but he puts it in there to demonstrate that the number you get out for hemoglobin's cooperative binding sites from that equation is 2.8. And this is not possible since we know hemoglobin is a tetramer and it has 4 binding sites. Thus, this shows that hemoglobin does not obey the Hill model. So it does not obey this all-or-nothing binding where all the subunits are empty and then the ligand binds to all four at once. Instead, it shows that oxygen, our ligand of interest, must bind incrementally to the protein hemoglobin. All right, so now we are going to look at two different models to describe hemoglobin's positive cooperativity. So on your left here, you should see Minot's concerted model, and on to the right, you should see the sequential model. Now in class, Dr. Peerage goes over both, and in the end, he explains that this concerted model is the true one that explains hemoglobin's sigmoidal curve. However, first we're going to start over by knowing the sequential model, and then we'll eventually get back to this concerted model. So over here in the sequential model, we say that there are intermediates that exist between the T state and the R state. And this is what's different from the concerted model, is this idea of having intermediates. So first we should start off by giving you a definition of what the T state is versus what the R state is. So the T state is the tense state, or the taut state of hemoglobin. And this is seen when hemoglobin is not bound to oxygen. However, the R state is the relaxed state, hence the prefix, or the first letter being R for relaxed, and that's when hemoglobin is bound to oxygen. And it's actually more stable when bound to oxygen versus when it's not. So what we have here is that the T state is present when there's no molecules of oxygen bound to any of the four subunits. However, as we have one molecule of oxygen bind to one of the four subunits, it induces a conformational shift in the adjacent subunits. So we'll see here, oxygen is bound to one of the four subunits, and that's shown by a blue circle, whereas the subunits that are adjacent are now this weird green, slightly curved subunit, and then our fourth unit over here is still a black square, showing that it's still taut in the T state. Now, this conformational shift increases the affinity of these next subunits to pick up oxygen. So it makes the next molecule of oxygen bind even more easier than this initial one. Now, we see that over here as the second molecule of oxygen binds, and this subunit that was still in our T state is now in this intermediate form. And it increases the likelihood that a third molecule of oxygen binds. And then eventually, when all four subunits are filled, we are in the R state. But what I want you to pull from here is that we have the T state and the R state, but in between those two states, we have intermediates. Now, if we come back over to this concerted model, we'll see that only the T state exists and only the R state exists, and nothing in between. So here I have the T state, which is actually pretty stable when there's no oxygen around. It's the most stable form in the absence of oxygen. However, once we introduce oxygen into the system, the R state will bind, and it's more stable in that state. And this is shown by on the y-axis over here, we have change in free energy. So as we have each consecutive molecule of oxygen bind to a subunit, there is a free energy change that's equivalent the whole way down. Now, what I want you to get from this is that this shows an increased availability of subunits as oxygen is introduced into the system and as oxygen binds. So over here, we have this equilibrium between the T state and the R state. This T state has a little naught subunit to it, subscript to it, and so I'll call this T naught. And as this R state has oxygen bind, Dr. Peerage said in class that this R state, R naught, is essentially killed. And what happens is this T naught transforms into an R naught in order to compensate. So think of like Le Chatelier's principle. So what happens is there's this increased availability of the R state as oxygen is introduced and binds. And that's why the concerted model here better explains the sigmoidal shape of hemoglobin is because of the greater availability of subunits rather than increased affinity of subunits. This concludes our video, and if you have any further questions about hemoglobin or myoglobin and cooperativity, I would go to your SI leader or go to walk-in hours. Good luck on the exam.
The Teaching Center, UF's Learning Resource Center.